And now to introduce our final keynote. Dr. Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala is Nigeria's coordinating minister for the economy and minister of finance. From 2007 to 2011, she was managing director of the World Bank, where she had oversight responsibility for the World Bank's operational portfolio in Africa, South and Central Asia, and Europe. Dr. Okonjo-Iweala spearheaded several World Bank initiatives to assist low-income countries during the food crisis and later the financial crisis. In 2010, she chaired a successful drive to raise $49.3 billion in grants and low-interest credit for the poorest countries in the world. Before her service as finance minister in 2003, Dr. Okonjo-Iweala had a 21-year career at the World Bank as a development economist, rising to the position of vice president and corporate secretary in 2002. Dr. Okonjo-Iweala was educated at Harvard University and has a PhD in regional economics and development from MIT. She is the recipient of numerous awards, including the President of the Italian Republic Gold Medal by Pierre Manzoo Center in 2011, honorary doctorates from Trinity College, Dublin, Brown, Amherst College, and Colby College, and the Universities of Port Harcourt, Obafemi Owolowo, Delta State in Nigeria, among others. She has been ranked among the top 100 women in the world by The Guardian in 2011, the top 150 women in the world by Newsweek magazine in 2011, and the top 3 most influential women in Africa by the Forbes magazine in 2012. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Okonjo-Iweala.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Trish, and good evening, everybody. Thank you for being here. This is an amazing audience. I'm surprised after, I don't know, 2 or 3 days of talks and seminars, I thought you would all be talked out, but you're here. Secondly, I want to say that Trish was very brave, but she obviously doesn't know the Nigerian custom of vote of thanks. You know, what happens is after people have spoken, then you take another 1 hour thanking everybody individually for having been there. You know, this could take you 2 or 3 hours in this hall. So I thought your vote of thanks was too efficient to be Nigerian. Well, I'm happy to be here, and I think it's a wonderful opportunity. I'm trying to remember the last time I was here was probably in 2004 or 2005 when I was first minister. So I'm pleased to join you today to deliver this closing keynote address for the conference on the topic of redefining Africa, the emergence of a new African story. It's always a pleasure to be able to come back to Boston and to have the opportunity to engage with all the young minds. I feel so much energy in this room from all the young Africans and lovers of Africa who are here. The British statesman Benjamin Disraeli once said that the youth of a nation, I quote, are the trustees of posterity. So make no mistake about this. I believe strongly that the future management of Africa's economies and governments will depend on all of you here and people like you. In other words, I'm already leaving you with a sense of responsibility that it's not just to come here and listen to me, but to take away something about how you're going to change things on this continent. This year's conference is about redefining Africa, the emergence of a new African story. Indeed, there is a new African story which is emerging. During his visit to Accra a few years ago, President Obama began his speech by reminding us that, quote, the 21st century will be shaped by what happens not just in Rome or Moscow or Washington, but what happens in Accra, and I would add, in Abuja. As well, I'm totally biased. And I'll tell you that what I say, my favorite quote is, if you're not in Nigeria, you're not in Africa. Okay. Okay, I'm not trying to be unfriendly to all the wonderful young Africans here from Ethiopia and Ghana and South Africa. I believe you all matter too, and the countries are... But as you all know, I'm an unabashed lover of Africa. And I really am extremely excited at what is happening. So don't get worried. Some people think she's so Pollyannish. She doesn't recognize the problems, but we'll get to them. Now, we all know that sub-Saharan African economies have experienced a growth spurt in recent years. Economic growth in the region has been robust, averaging almost 5% per year for the past decade, compared with 2.5% annual growth for the global economy. And while natural resources have been important, a very interesting part of this growth story has also occurred outside natural resources in the services and manufacturing sectors. A decade ago, many investors viewed African economies as some frontier markets with unknown risks. Today, Africa's leading economies are solidly recognized as emerging markets. And I actually had a confirmation of that this morning when I had breakfast with some institutional investors, and they talked about our markets as having emerged. That is very exciting. The London FTSE launched a Pan-African ex-South Africa index in January aimed at fund managers who want to diversify their portfolios and also tap into some of the high returns offered by African equities. Just last week, the Financial Times newspaper reported cheekily that, quote, there is a second scramble for Africa underway. Nigerian stocks have returned almost 63% in US dollar terms during the past 12 months. Kenya's Nairobi All-Share Index has returned 46%, and Ghana's market has climbed more than 17%, unquote. And although we still have serious challenges, and I told you I would talk about them, such as youth unemployment, growing inequality, and poverty, we are also witnessing the rise of a distinct middle class in Africa. The African Development Bank recently published a study which showed the rise of the middle class in Africa. The African middle class has tripled since the 1980s, with a total size of about 330 million people, or 34% of the population. These are individuals with annual income in purchasing power parity terms of $3,900 US dollars, and who are gradually becoming the consumer class for all types of goods, such as household electronics, financial services, and groceries. This middle class is growing largely because of sustained economic growth, more salaried jobs, and the growth of the services sector. So I'm convinced that there is an emerging story on Africa today. The question is, what role would each one of you play in this new story? Let me use this closing address then to make a few remarks, and then hopefully we can engage in a bit of Q&A afterwards. I'll talk briefly about three things. First, how we sustain the economic rise in Africa. Second, how we consolidate governance reforms, especially governance management of natural resources. And third, discuss emerging opportunities for entrepreneurs in Africa today. So first, sustaining Africa's economic rise. We cannot be complacent about Africa's economic resurgence. We cannot be complacent. Let us not forget that this resurgence we are witnessing is being achieved on the back of some very difficult reforms, which we started on the continent in the 1990s. If you recall, many African countries had to undertake political reforms, improve their macroeconomic policies, and also introduce various structural reforms. Many countries were in conflict, and those conflicts needed to be stopped and managed. These changes laid the foundations for some of the economic growth which we are observing today. Whether you look at macroeconomic indicators or structural reform measures, it is clear that African economies have come a long way in the past two decades, though they still have a long way to go. First, let us look at a few things. Sovereign debts have shrunk, creating fiscal space for critical expenditure. By the late 1990s, African countries had high levels of debt, with countries such as Zambia owing more than 235% of GDP in debt, Cote d'Ivoire 109%, Ghana 123%, Nigeria 72%. Today, the region's debt to GDP ratio has declined to about 32% of GDP. How many of you knew that? Put up your hands. You see, not many people know that this is one of the strong things on which we are riding. And we thank those of our donors to whom, our creditors, to whom we owe owed money, who supported the Highly Indebted Poor Countries Initiative, HIPIC, and for Nigeria, Special Debt Relief. In fact, when you were talking, I thought that was what you were going to talk about, because the cancellation of $18 billion in Nigeria's debt and the wiping out of $30 billion out of 36 is a singular big achievement that has allowed the economy to have breathing room. And so it has been all over Africa. So we are now in a very good place. Inflation has also declined. Sub-Saharan Africa's struggles with hyperinflation, I hope, are now behind us. The IMF has now calculated that the region's inflation rate, which was about 48% in 1994, I don't think many people even remember that, has declined to below 9% in recent times. Financial deepening. Credit to the private sector has increased steadily in the past two decades, rising from about 42% of GDP in 1990 to about 64% of GDP in 2009. Our financial markets are also improving with stronger banks today and stock exchanges, which now attract the attention of global fund managers, as I just said in the beginning. Privatization programs have been an achievement. A broad range of privatization programs were implemented in the sub-Saharan African region, some of them not without without problems. But in a large part, many of these programs managed to reduce wasteful public spending. For example, in the 1990s, about 2,300 public assets were privatized in sub-Saharan Africa, generating about $9 billion in revenues. For the case of Nigeria, I commend you to a chapter in my book, which I'll mention. This is it, and you have a chance to hear more about it, which is called Reforming the Unreformable, Lessons from Nigeria. Here you... Well, I wouldn't talk about it or have the courage, except I hear it's selling out on Amazon, so better get your copy. But if you want to learn about privatization and the achievements and how hard it is, even as we speak, this is a good place for reference. We've also done many investment climate reforms. Many African countries are paying close attention to the doing business rankings of the World Bank Group, and also taking steps to improve the business regulatory environment. We have a long way to go. We are still ranking quite low, many of our countries, in this index, meaning we have so many reforms to embark on. But it looks like changing the business environment is taking hold, because the latest Doing Business report mentions that 36 out of 46 African economies were embarking at least on one reform. Things like facilitating business registration, fast-tracking property permits, enhancing legal protection for investors, and so on. And some of the post-conflict countries like Liberia and Sierra Leone are interestingly countries that are doing very well. And we know, of course, that Rwanda, coming out of a long period of conflict, is also one among the top performers in recent years. Improving human development indicators. And overall, the continent's development indicators are trending upwards. I don't think they're doing that fast enough. We will miss many of the MDGs by 2015, but the region has reached about 60% of the target levels for the Millennium Development Goals. But we are not complacent, we are not happy, we think we need to push more so that our human development indicators will improve. In my country in particular, Nigeria, we have a lot of work to do to improve maternal mortality rates and infant mortality rates. It's just not good enough to be growing at a relatively fast rate when your human development indicators are not improving enough. I think it's unacceptable that we should have women die in childbirth when we know the technology, we know the answers, we know what to do. And these are some of the things we must focus on. Looking ahead, I would say that African policymakers need to maintain the good macroeconomic policies which have served us so well in recent years. But then we also need to pay great attention, and we are paying, to creating jobs, investing in infrastructure and in skills, and also tackling the widening inequality. Let me just touch briefly on these problems. I've said what it is we are doing right, we need to maintain it, but there are also things we need to do much better on. Infrastructure. I know we all know about it, so I won't dwell too long, but I have to say that the infrastructure deficit in power and transport sectors remains one of the binding constraints on economic growth on the continent. To provide some numbers, the sub-Saharan Africa region, with a total population of nearly 800 million, generates only about 2% of the world's electricity output, equal to the total power output of Spain. For roads, we know that transportation costs in Africa are more than twice the corresponding costs in other BRIC economies. Why am I stressing the infrastructure challenges? Well, because overall, it reduces the productivity of African firms by about 40%. Whether you're looking at small SMEs like a tailoring shop down the road or a large industrial manufacturer, the World Bank estimates that overall, Africa's infrastructure deficit lowers the region's economic growth by about 2 percentage points each year. We cannot afford this. For us in Nigeria, we are trying to tackle some of these challenges. For example, by undertaking a sweeping privatization of our power sector and also pursuing various public-private partnerships in our transportation sector. We recently signed an MOU with General Electric to assist in developing power, rail, and healthcare infrastructure, just as an example, with a view to them putting in about 10,000 megawatts of power over the next 10 years. But what is really exciting is the open and transparent manner in which the power sector privatization has been done. All the generating units and the distribution units are being sold, all 17 of them. And only transmission remains in the hands of government, and it's being outsourced. Government is acknowledging that maybe we are not the best to manage this resource and has been outsourced for management to Manitoba Hydro of Canada. We still have a host of problems to solve in making the power sector work well, but I think we are on the path to a very exciting way of approaching this. We've opened up the sector, liberalizes so that people can come in and generate and sell power. And I hope that all this will help us manage the single binding constraint of infrastructure in the country, which is power. In terms of education and skills training, the second challenge which African policymakers must bear in mind concerns investing in skills development of their citizens, particularly for youth. I realized there was one of the conference panel sessions this afternoon discussing this very topic. In a nutshell, the challenge is that the sub-Saharan Africa faces a pending demographic bulge as the size of the youth population is projected to rise. In general, with a growing youth population, the ratio of the non-working age to the working age population, the dependency ratio, declines. This results in rising per capita incomes for everyone, and it's called the demographic dividend. But this dividend only works if you can find jobs, create jobs for this youth. If we are unable to create the jobs, then it becomes a demographic nightmare and not a dividend. What we need to avoid is that nightmare. And we have good examples of this working in the Asian Tigers, South Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore, over the period 1965 and to 1990, and they managed this well. So capturing this demographic dividend requires some careful planning. For example, it would be necessary to invest in skills training for youth and create jobs that fully harness youth potential. McKinsey estimates that some additional 122 million workers will enter Africa's labor force by 2020. And by 2035, the size of the African labor force will be greater than that of any other nation, including China. We therefore need to look ahead and invest in training. We need to work more with industry. We need a partnership between government and industry to create skills in practical areas, technical and vocational skills, for example, professional craftsmen such as welders, carpenters, plumbers, electricians, mechanics, and so on. Our tertiary education curricula also needs to be more entrepreneurial so that our graduates become job creators rather than job seekers. I'll return to this job creation point in the final section of the talk. But I'm really worried about what I call the missing middle in our jobs, that of vocational training. You often find in our countries this lack of this technical skills, craftsmen. In Nigeria, when we need to build houses, we often turn to Togo, to Benin and Ghana to get good craftsmen. You know, my joke, and that of my husband who is in the audience, if you're building something in Nigeria and then the person does the wall or the, you know, the piece of iron and it's a little bit bent, it should be straight, or puts the tile in the bathroom, and then you say to them, but this doesn't look quite right. They say, I'll manage it now. It's good enough, you know? I call it the manage it syndrome. And when you're not prepared to manage it, you don't like mediocrity. She's too difficult. But we must get away from the manage it syndrome. You know, the worst thing I like to hear is manage it now. It's okay. So I believe strongly that in our economies, we must train for excellence in this category of jobs and that we have the imperative to do it. How about widening inequality? Before I wrap up this section on economic policy, let me also say a few things about widening inequality. Despite Africa's recent strong growth and the rising middle class I spoke about, many poor households are being left behind, and the gap between the rich and the poor is widening. As the Arab Spring taught us, rising inequality and youth discontent are a volatile cocktail mix that could have serious political consequences. This trend is not peculiar to Africa. In fact, just today, or was it yesterday, I read about rising inequality here. As incomes, I think it was in the New York Times or Financial Times, incomes are increasing here, but they are only growing for the top 1 or 2%, and those at the bottom of the ladder are falling behind. Many fast-growing emerging economies such as China, Indonesia, Brazil are experiencing the same thing. Economists use the Gini index to assess the extent of inequality. This is an index that measures the concentration of household incomes, and a higher index implies higher inequality. To give you some numbers for reference, China, with its rapid growth and rising inequality, has a Gini index of 42. For Africa, 24 countries have Gini indices higher than China. For Nigeria, the Gini is 49. For Mozambique, 46. For Botswana and South Africa, the index is over 60. So we have to deal with this problem of rising inequality, and I'm very worried about it. So even as we grow, we must find ways and means to try and tackle what is happening at the bottom end of the scale. And I strongly believe that the way to do it is jobs. Of course, in Brazil, President Lula introduced the Bolsa Familia, which is a program that tries makes transfers to poor households, and that has managed to bring up the bottom in Brazil and to create a social safety net that has helped the country deal with questions of inequality. But in many African countries, you find many policy makers afraid of such large subsidy programs because they often turn strictly into entitlements. They may become unsustainable and hard to deal with. So we have to devise our own social safety nets and transfer programs which we can manage in terms of sustainability within our budgets. We're trying to do that in Nigeria by creating jobs at the bottom of the scale through a community services scheme, which we started, aimed at creating 320,000 jobs for youth, unskilled youth in labor-intensive activities per year, 320,000 per year. We've also started a graduate internship program in the country, which is designed to help with unemployed young graduates. And President Goodluck Jonathan, people ask me, what keeps him awake at night? Well, what keeps him awake at night is the issue of jobs, the lack of jobs for youth. And he pushes every minister. Your brief is to do what you can to create jobs by working across sectors that are sources of growth like agriculture, housing, et cetera, but also through some direct activities like the one that we mentioned. And I'll say a bit more about that. Right now, this graduate internship program, I commend it to you because several companies have actually come to me and said they would be interested in getting young people from the diaspora to participate in this. So if you're interested and you're willing to work for quote unquote minimal wages for a year, I didn't think you would be interested. Not out of Harvard MBA, having to pay back your loans, but I thought I would mention it. You never know. But for those who are interested, we are willing to take you. After working for 1 year, the government gives incentives to private sector companies that retain the people who have worked for them. And some of them have, like Nestle and so on, have expressed interest in getting some diaspora people. Now let me move on to the second big area where we have issues. You know, I talked about the first one, which is trying to solve our infrastructure problems and so on. The second one is consolidating governance. So the next challenge we have has to do with entrenching good governance in our African countries. Corruption and lack of transparency is still a big problem on our continent, as it is elsewhere. But I say even if it's elsewhere, we can least afford it because of our large numbers of poor people. We can least afford to lose money to corruption. There has been some recent progress in trying to improve governance compared to the 1990s. Let's take the issue of democracy. You may not notice it, but today many African countries are now multi-party democracies, and several of them have had multiple elections. I believe that up to 33 countries now have gone through more than one election. And some of these elections are pretty amazing. The example of Ghana, where the margin between the opposition that lost and the party that won was so thin the first time, the election, and this second time around. And yet, there was a peaceful handover of power without too much agitation, I think deserves a clap. In my own country, Nigeria, we have to commend President Goodluck Ebele Jonathan for having run an election that independent monitors said was one of the freest and fairest in the country, and that gave him a lot of support and credibility for his term. For 2013, presidential or legislative elections, you can clap if you wish. For 2013, presidential or legislative elections are expected in Cameroon, Djibouti, Ethiopia, Equatorial Guinea. It's more than 10 countries are running elections, and we hope that we will all learn to respect that a democracy means you have a lively opposition, and that if they win, you know you should gracefully bow out and not try to create problems. I hope in Nigeria the same will be the case. But it also means an opposition that is a constructive opposition, not a destructive one. One of the things of our democracies in Africa that is a little bit difficult is that sometimes the opposition feels they have to grind the ruling party into the dust in order to win. I don't think so. I really believe in opposition, but we should all, you know, very rarely in the US do you hear somebody denigrating the United States? Even if, do you ever hear Republicans saying that the US is the worst country they ever lived in? I'm sure they will say that Obama's policies, they don't agree, and that they might be damaging the country, but they don't denigrate their own country, even if they are not in power. I think it's sometimes in our countries we hear opposition say, this is the worst country, nothing works here, there's nothing good, etc. You know, the feeling is if you run the country into the ground, then surely you will win the election. My answer is that's not the way to go. Now, you know, there's one thing I want to talk about in terms of our processes and in terms of consolidating governance that we don't often talk about, and that's financing the democratic process. We need to continue working at building institutions and consolidating our democracies. A key issue is how to minimize political corruption from infecting our democracies. This is not solely an African problem. It's everywhere, but I always say that these problems can least be afforded by us on the continent because we're poorer. No one wants to discuss the big problem of how to finance election campaigns and political parties. Where do the resources come from? In many developing countries, including on our continent, what we observe is a symbiotic relationship between business and politics, where business helps to finance the politics and in turn gets returns economic favors that can result in substantial rents. But some of these rents can be quite distorting in terms of economic growth. And it's interesting to me that people hardly want to talk about this, but I think it fundamentally is also adding to the issue of corruption on the continent. In Asia, Lee Kuan Yew termed this commercial democracy. And we're observing this same pernicious trend in Africa. We urgently need to do something about it, and we need to apply our minds. We are not naive. Political parties have to be financed. Elections have to be financed. The issue is, can we find a less pernicious way of making this work that does not undermine overall economic development and corrode the moral fabric of society? I'm commending this to you. I know Kenya is looking at an election campaign financing bill, and we're looking at them eagerly to see if they can come up with an answer that will enable us to also emulate and move forward in a very good way. But we have large numbers of very bright young African people here. So what I'm doing is asking you to put your minds to this problem and see, are there mechanisms that we can come up with that can enable us to tackle this problem of financing democracy without fundamentally undermining our economic systems? The other governance challenge is the governance of natural resources. As you know, the resource map in Africa has changed significantly in the past decade. For example, new petroleum deposits have been discovered in Ghana, Uganda, Kenya, Tanzania, Mozambique, and so on. It's no longer only Nigeria and Angola that are pumping oil. Almost every country has some oil or gas deposits being discovered by the minute. That means that resource-rich countries, of which we have many in Africa, really need to step up in terms of issues of transparency and accountability in the way they manage their resources. You know, we are all very much in favor of stronger transparency, stronger accountability. In this regard, I made a number of recommendations, which I discussed recently in China to the Chinese Mining Association in Tianjin, and also recently at a lecture in Oxford. I'll just mention a few of the things that I think we need to think about as policymakers. First, African policymakers and leaders need to be more transparent in the negotiations of these natural resource mining contracts by allowing open and competitive bidding for mining concessions. Practices of battery mining licenses for infrastructure projects are inherently difficult to evaluate and will be perceived as being non-transparent. Hostility from local communities is also likely to be high if contract negotiations are believed to be mired in secrecy. Second, we, African policymakers, need to do our homework thoroughly before we begin contract negotiations with foreign mining firms. In many cases, there's wide information asymmetry between foreign contractor firms and host government officials. So African government officials should invest more in building technical capacities and improving negotiation skills before entering into contract negotiations. I'm saying this to you because I know many of you here in law school and, of course, in business school, we strongly and sorely need those kinds of skills in mining, oil and gas negotiations, lawyers with those skills, people who know how to carry out these kinds of negotiations. They are a very scarce commodity. So if anyone is still wondering what profession to go into, I've just given you one. Thirdly, African leaders should also build institutions which promote transparency and accountability in the manage of the resource revenues. There are some useful audit frameworks, such as the natural resource charters developed by Paul Colley and colleagues, and also the Extractive Industries Transparency Initiative. In Nigeria, we are still struggling to build and maintain institutions for managing our natural resources, but we are making tremendous progress. Today, We have our oil price-based fiscal rule, which sets the price of at which we budget below the prevailing oil price and enables us to save. And we have now been able to build our buffer back from about $4.3 billion in mid last year when I first came to government to about $9.2 billion now, whilst establishing a sovereign wealth fund with an initial capital of $1 billion, which we, of course, hope to build up in the nearest future. Clearly, transparency and fighting corruption will be critical to harness as much of our domestic resources as possible, given the paucity of donor assistance. I really want to repeat that. I have a strong belief that countries that are very donor-dependent, depending for 40 to 50% or more of their budgets on donor financing, need to pay attention to how they can harness domestic resources more carefully, because the future of donor assistance is not very bright. And we have the capacity within our continent to do this. The issue is the will to make our populations believe that we'll use these resources wisely and therefore help get them to help us to build up our own domestic buffers. Now, fourthly, you can have a role in helping to build these transparency frameworks by finding frameworks within which you can share information on what government is doing and what the flows, resource flows are within government to make it much more accountable. In this regard, I want to commend you to a website, www.transparentnigeria.com, which shares information on resource flows and other vital pieces of information on Nigeria in particular that many people who want to hold government more accountable may be interested in. Now, you know, there's truth in advertising here, and I must be very transparent. When my young adult sons and daughter were talking about how can we hold government more accountable, I challenged them to do something about it, and one of them did. His name is Uche Chiwala, and he's the one who developed this website. I think it's amazing. Please visit it. I commend all of you. I hope he's not somewhere cringing. But I think it's a wonderful effort, and we'd like more of such efforts to try and share information and make the resource flows available. Information is power. And if people do not have information, they cannot hold their governments accountable. So this is something very important. Now, what are the emerging opportunities for entrepreneurs in Africa? I've talked about the wins that we have. I've talked about the challenges and problems. Now, let's look at some of the opportunities. Once economic reforms are in place and governance is improving, we need to turn to the final task of creating jobs in our countries. This is where the entrepreneurs come in. And this is where you in the audience can play your part. You should have the mindset of returning to the continent to contribute to economic growth. And I think there are many promising areas to explore, which I'll share with you. In agriculture, in housing and real estate, manufacturing, infrastructure, and so on. Let's look at some of these promising sectors. First, information technology, mobile and internet technologies. Mobile and internet technologies are providing us with an unprecedented opportunity on the continent to leapfrog our economic development. We need to get creative and to adapt these technologies to our local settings to solve local problems. These technologies can be creatively deployed across many sectors, such as financial services, healthcare delivery, agriculture, energy, and so forth. According to the World Bank in 2012, there were about 650 million mobile phone subscribers in Africa. To put this number in perspective, it is more than the combined populations of US, Canada, and Mexico. African mobile subscribers have these technologies in their hands. What services can you, our young entrepreneurs, deliver to them? That's the question that I have. I know that we have some very interesting internet services coming up, and we have young retailers like Jumai.com and Conga.com, which are being managed by recent HBS alums. Do they happen to be in this audience? No, but this is something, I think we need to give them a hand. They operate essentially like Amazon.com for the Nigerian market. And of course, there are a number of other innovative applications that we are all very familiar with. Everybody knows about M-Pesa, which has spread from Kenya all over East Africa now. I also want to talk about an example that I saw a few days ago, which the people who brought it to me called democratizing energy. Some investors came to my office to pitch an idea which I fell in love with. They had a product which, like the mobile phone, you know, if it can be properly managed and invested in, could bring energy to bottom of the pyramid consumers. So what's their idea? Well, they realized that for solar energy, which many people are, you know, coming up with applications of, the initial capital investment cost for a solar panel of about $300 is too high for many low-income households. So they devised a financing solution using mobile payments, where the consumer can now install the technology at home for a small fee and then make payments by SMS on a weekly or monthly basis to activate the discharge of this solar energy. You can Google them at Nova Lumos to learn more. I thought this was a very, very clever idea. And a very clever idea. I mean, the solar energy panel they brought is not too large, and the lamp was really, really very bright as the one you can see up there. And, you know, you can get, with a small 50-cent fee or 75 cents, rural households and poor households can get access to light. We are not going to be able to have on-grid solutions for everyone, so this is an off-grid solution. And it's also scalable from one light to two, from one panel to two to three, so that small entrepreneurs, the tailor down the street, the welder, can also have access to electricity. So this is an application, and I said, this is very interesting. These were young Israeli entrepreneurs. If they can do these things, I know that we are coming up with many more. Of course, we've got the M-Pedigree, which you've all heard about, which helps us with monitoring fake drugs. And then e-wallets. To cite a public sector example in Nigeria, we recently, especially through the Minister of Agriculture, implemented an e-wallet payment scheme. And there's great skepticism about it at home. Many people do not believe, but under this scheme, rural farmers are receiving vouchers for purchase of agricultural inputs, seeds and fertilizers directly on their mobile phones. And I think with time, people will come to believe that this application will have a very great impact on the way agriculture is done in the country. So what am I saying? Basically, mobile telephony provides a platform to implement a whole range of applications on our continent, and I hope you take advantage of it. Let me also mention briefly light manufacturing. Today, there's research which shows that Asian economies are gradually slowing down as their wage costs begin to rise. The prediction is that Africa could emerge as the next preferred destination for labor-intensive manufacturing of goods, such as garments and shoes. This is an opportunity for Africa's entrepreneurs and engineers. Let us remember that we provide a huge domestic market, will soon be 1 billion people with a growing middle class. And so those that are able to enter into this kind of market and entrepreneurship will be the first thing to make a great deal of money. McKinsey estimated that consumer spending in Africa hit about $1 trillion last year. And the Chinese seem to have spotted this opportunity and are beginning to open many of these labor-intensive type of factories in Africa. For example, the Hujian Group in Ethiopia and the shoe factory they've opened there is a very good example. The creative arts sector cannot be left behind. I know I don't want to talk about Nollywood, which you're all familiar with, but it is creating a lot of jobs. And there's still room there to burnish our products, make the quality better, and in doing so, create large numbers of jobs for our young people. And I leave it to you all to figure out how to do this and have a truly global impact. African fashion, the fashion industry holds great promise. And some of our fashion-conscious MBAs can help take it to the next level. In 2010, Actis acquired the Lisco Group, which makes Dutch wax fabric, for US$151 million. They came and saw me, and they are motivated by the potential of the African fashion market. not just for traditional wear like I have on, but also for modern contemporary outfits. I believe there's a huge opportunity here. Let me end with a very interesting area in which I feel there's a lot of opportunity, which is housing and real estate. In Nigeria, we are intent on creating a housing market. You will not believe we have 20,000 mortgages in a country of 167 million. And there's a huge opportunity in the housing sector. We are 17 million units in deficit, with 2 million units to be added each year. But the big reason we have this deficit is because we do not have a housing finance sector that can really take up the slack. So we are creating that. We are creating a Nigerian mortgage refinance company to be private sector owned with government participation, which will help us securitize and be able to refinance mortgages. And we hope that this, with a concerted attack to deal with several of the problems, such as dealing with foreclosure issues, land titling, making this faster, is going to unleash the potential of housing. And as you know, housing has many forward and backward linkages within the economy. This is going to unleash a large number of jobs. We have several states that have agreed to be pilot states, like Lagos, the Federal Capital Territory, Bauchi, Anambra, and so on. What we want to do is work with a few states, since it's such a large country, cement this, and then make it nationwide. And it's very exciting to think that by the end of this year, or at the latest, the beginning of next year, young professional people might actually be able to walk in and get a mortgage to buy a home. I believe this will give hope to thousands and millions of young people in our country that this is something that they can attain in their lifetime. So let me now conclude with a few thoughts. Last month, I was in Monrovia attending the UN high-level panel meeting on the Millennium Development Goals, convened by President Sirleaf. I hope we're not having a NEPA moment. For those who don't know what I said, you know, our company, our power company, which we are privatizing, used to be NEPA, the Nigerian Electric Power Authority, which became PHCN. But in Nigeria, when things don't work, we call it a NEPA moment. Let me conclude. I was in Monrovia last month attending the UN high-level panel meeting on the Millennium Development Goals, convened by President Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, Prime Minister Cameron of the UK, and President Yudhoyono of Indonesia. We were discussing the post-2015 development agenda, that is, the next set of development targets which should be adopted once the Millennium Development Goals come to an end in 2015. And as you can imagine, many panelists had their suggestions for new targets in poverty reduction, tackling climate change, and so on. These targets are likely to span 2015 to 2030, so they're really targets for your generation to implement. In Monrovia, I made the point that young Africans today do not want to be thinking about disease, poverty reduction, infant mortality, and so on. Many in the young generation tell me they are interested in hearing about investments, job creation, and economic growth. That is, I'm not saying, or they were not saying to me, that aid will no longer be relevant, but rather they see aid as increasingly leveraging and facilitating private investments. And the theme of this conference, the emergence of a new African story, reinforces this view. I'm very confident that the Africa of tomorrow, the Africa that your generation inherits, would be better governed, would be stronger economies, will create more jobs for the labor force, and ultimately would be more prosperous. But it can only be all these things if you yourself apply yourself to the problem. I always tell the young generation in Africa that it's not only about what your policymakers can do or should do, it's also about what you as an individual can do. How are you applying yourself to solve the problems, however difficult the entry back into your country is? How can you apply yourself to make a difference? The third US President Thomas Jefferson once remarked that he quote, liked the dreams of the future, better than the history of the past. I think the same can be said of my view for Africa in the coming years. I'm really optimistic that you, the next generation of entrepreneurs and young professionals, will rise to this challenge in contributing to a more prosperous continent. You are the reason why I am optimistic, and I hope and know that you will deliver. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
And now we'll have a few questions. If there's anyone who'd like to ask Dr. Okonjo-Iweala a question, please come down to the front.
Thank you for coming. I really like your speech. My question is about Nigeria's power sector. Currently, you burn some of your own domestic crude oil to generate electricity. So if you use clean energy instead, you would save more of your own crude oil to sell at the export price, which is much higher than the domestic price. And this idea has been adopted in the Middle East and in Northern Africa and Algeria. Do you know if it could work in Nigeria?
Okay, why don't I take like three at a time, you know?
Could you go ahead and ask your question, please?
Thank you. Yes.
Hi, my name is Ade Ajayi, and like you, I'm also a proud Nigerian. a lot of my friends have moved back to Nigeria in recent years, and the struggle continues. We don't have lack of ideas or lack of innovation. With a lot of the young Nigerians that you see here. The challenge is really access to credit infrastructures, right? As you know, in developing countries or developed countries, you always see an emerging small and mid-sized businesses through government support from loans to small businesses. What is Africa doing, specifically Nigeria, if you can speak to that, to enhance access to credit infrastructures so that ideas don't die with us? Thank you.
The third one.
Thank you so much. As we will say, Auntie Ngozi, we are very proud of you. We all want to be like you when we grow up. My name is Aminu Gamawa, and I'm a PhD student at the law school. I specialize in negotiation and dispute system design. So perhaps this is something that Nigeria may, my services may be useful, as you mentioned. My question is related to recent remarks made by your colleague under the Obasanjo administration, and then, of course, your colleague at the World Bank as well, Dr. Obi Ezekwesili, about the mismanagement of funds by the current Nigerian government. If you are not willing or you don't want to comment on that charges, I will ask a variation of the question, which is, you served under Obasanjo and you are serving under Goodluck Jonathan. Do you see any improvement in terms of transparency and accountability? If not, in what way have you contributed to that? Because you represent transparency in our own way. And finally, on women. I think women are very important. You have mentioned many things. Every time I go back to my village, despite all the indices that are showing that there is development in Africa, in Nigeria, the same woman who is selling either from wine or goro is the same woman that is doing the same thing. In what way, what are you doing to empower women? Not everyone has the opportunity of coming to Harvard or having an education. Thank you.
Okay, let me take those three. Okay, thank you very much. Excellent questions. On the power sector, for a long time, you know, we were flaring gas. I think the issue is not our crude oil, but gas. We have, we are probably more of a gas nation. We have the 11th largest reserves of gas. And we were not using it for our domestic power. We were flaring it, and then we were liquefying it and exporting. So that whole thing has changed now. There's a gas master plan for the country, and we're increasingly using our gas to power our stations. And so that is happening, and that is an alternative, that is cleaner energy, and we're contributing to lowering the incidence of, to contributing to improving climate change by stopping flaring. We had hoped that by 2008, all the flaring of gas would stop. We haven't quite got there. But we hope in the next 2 or 3 years we would do that. Now, you'll notice that most of the power stations we now have and the new ones that are coming on are all being powered by gas. So this is a big improvement. Now, we need to put in the infrastructure so that domestic use of this gas as opposed to industrial use. If you ask the Dangotes, his plants, cement factories, which are very power intensive, are powered primarily by gas. So he has a pipeline and, an agreement to buy this gas from the gas, from the oil companies that are also selling the gas. So I think we are fully on the ball there. We are going to increasingly develop the infrastructure. You need to build the pipes to take the gas from where it is to the station. And this is very costly. But we've got a master plan to do that. And I think that that will be a sea change in the way that we're doing business. With regards to the access to credit question, this is a very, very big problem in the economy. We have to admit that. We often challenge our banks that we cleaned up the banks and the banking sector is very strong now. But part of what we wanted them to do was really to finance the real sector. And there's not enough of that happening, particularly with SMEs. But also, I think the biggest challenge we have in the country is the lack of long-term financing. It is almost impossible to get 10 to 15-year money. And we're doing something about it. Just as I said that we are creating a Nigerian mortgage refinance institution, which will be mostly private sector owned, we are creating a development finance institution for the country. This is brand new. The decision has just been made, which will wholesale finance to both the specialized banking institutions as well as the commercial banks. But it will be term money, 10 to 15 years. It will take us about 18 months to get to the point where we have this institution operational. But when we have it, these institutions, the banking sector and so on, will have access to longer term credit that they can then pass on. So now, just give us a little bit of time, I say 18 months, to try to improve on the term financing issue. And we are working to lower the inflation rate in the country so that interest rates can come down and access will be more affordable for those who are doing small businesses. But I do agree with you, it is a big problem and we are not just sitting still. We are working actively to make finance available. We also have some special programs that we're trying to use to encourage entrepreneurs, but I don't want to take up too much of your time to do that. I think it's easier to work on something institutional and larger that can really open up access to finance for industry, and particularly for small businesses. The third question was on the mismanagement of resources and the issue that was raised by my former colleague and sister. It's not that I don't want to answer directly. I think every attempt has been made in every way to draw me into this debate. And I'm sure some people are waiting to tweet as we speak and make headlines. First of all, I don't want to enter into dialogues that are not based on accurate information. So before you start debating things, you need to have the right information. And simply, what was said is not based on accurate information. The government has reacted by putting out the information there. It is from the central bank. It's there for everyone to see, and it speaks for itself. You can trace the trajectory of reserves and the excess crude account. The excess crude account is part of the reserves. And it's all published for everyone to see. So before you engage in a debate about mismanagement or management, you've got to do it on the basis of accurate information. Do you agree? Yes. You don't want to embark on a debate based on the wrong premises, do you? So once the premise is accepted, then you can begin to talk. And if you look at those resources, look at what was published by the central bank, you will see that the numbers quoted were not the correct ones. So that is simply my answer to that. Now, if the issue is that government should be more accountable, absolutely. I'm for that. I've always said that. I've repeated that in my lecture. I believe in accountability, that government should be held to more account. But please, and I said, do share information to do that. But when you do that, share accurate information. There is a very strong penchant in Nigeria for people to just throw out numbers any which way they like, with very little regard for accuracy. And somehow, the larger, the better. You know, and whether it's correct or not, nobody cares, because there's so much mistrust of government in our countries, on the continent. But in Nigeria, there's a great deal of lack of trust. The social compact between the people and the government is fragile, isn't it? So because of that, anyone can get up and say anything, and people will believe them. They don't even bother to check. Even when you're putting out the accurate information, they don't even want to believe. So I don't want to engage in fruitless debates that are not based on accurate information, okay? So when you present me that information, we'll debate it. Secondly, yes, clap if you want to. You know, then secondly, I totally believe in accountability. And you asked, what have I been doing? I've done the best I can. You know, one of the reasons why I'm in government, along with some other people who are working their hearts out to do things right. We have the Nigerian ambassador to the U.S. is here. Ambassador Adefuye, please stand up. You know, Ambassador Adefuye is one of the most hardworking ambassadors I've known here in trying to present a good face of the country, to present a good information, accurate information. Accurate information does not mean that it's necessarily information supporting government. You see what I'm saying? It could be against government, but at least it's correct. Then you can begin to discern what to do when the information is not so good. Now, I tell you some of the things that we're doing to be more transparent and have continued to do. Number one, we are publishing the revenues of each tier of government every single month. How many of you have ever seen this? In the newspapers every month, we publish what each tier of government gets. The federal government, the state governments, the local governments. We started it during President Obasanjo's time. It was stopped for somewhere in the middle. We've restarted it so that each person knows, what did my local government get this month? What did my state get this month? What did the federal government get? That is the accountability. And that's information. You can use it to call up and say, look, you got X, whether it's state, federal, or whatever. What have you done with it? That would be a more accurate conversation, don't you think? It's there every month. We have even compiled it into information that is publicly available. This is not a secret. And you can use it to judge. You can use it. And many people have used it. To ask questions of their policymakers in their states. This has been a fundamental basis to challenge what local government chairmen are doing. What state governors are doing, or what the federal government in each ministry is doing. And we also carry this information on our website, if you will, so anyone can look at that. I believe in sharing information, so anytime that people are desirous of having information on what we are doing in that government, we publish as much. Do you know we also publish how much is saved under the subsidy reinvestment program? You know, how many of you know the money we clawed back from phasing out of the petroleum subsidies? That's what I'm talking about. This is being used for social safety net programs like improving maternal mortality, infant mortality deep in our rural areas, improving our roads, and so on. The states get a share, the federal government gets a share. We also publish that each month. How many of you have seen that? Well, you know, the frustration is that many of the things we are doing, people don't even see or know about. You can take a horse to water, but you can't force it to drink. So we are giving you information, but nobody seems to. You know, if you have any ideas of what more we can do to share this transparent information, please tell me, we'll be willing to do that. But I've just given you a couple of examples. Now, in terms of empowering women, let me tell you what we are trying to do. Now, women, we for the first time, when we talk about empowering women, we have to make it real. For the first time in our budget, we are offering special budgetary incentives to 5 pilot ministries who are going to do specific things to improve the lives of women in the rural areas. For example, on maternal health, for example, in water resources, for example, in agriculture. When they deliver specific targets for women, we give them additional budgetary resources. This has never been done before. We want to bring this down to the grassroots. And so that's my answer to the person who says, what are you actually doing to empower women? Thank you. Maybe 3 more. Okay, let me take as many questions from those standing, and then I'll try to amalgamate the answers.
All right, we'll take a couple more questions from there, a couple more questions from here, and then we'll have to wrap this up.
Thank you for coming, madam. My name is Dabo Horsfall. I'm from River State, Nigeria, and currently an investment professional at Morgan Stanley's Global Infrastructure Fund. I read your book, and on balance, it was very positive, but you also shed light into some of the challenges and disappointments that you faced. And so the question to you is, how do you find your compass and focus on the goal after facing extreme challenges? And also, if you could also talk about the Sovereign Wealth Fund initiative and how that and what your vision is for that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're going to ask that everyone ask their questions in 15 seconds, just your name and one question, please.
Okay, my name is Alachi Oswegi, and my question really is around increasing high quality education in Nigeria. There's a big gap, there's a big human capital waste going on in Nigeria because education isn't skills oriented or skills driven. So my question is, what is the government doing to make sure that education available at the tertiary level, at the vocational level, even at the secondary level, is more directed towards skill acquisition so that those skills can be turned into jobs?
Thank you very much. Next question, please.
My name is Toby Kuejo. I'm a consultant with Accenture. My question is, in Nigeria and in most developing countries in West Africa, there's a lot of small and medium enterprises, but there's a gap between the growth from an SME to becoming a Dangote. And so how do we fill that dead zone in which companies aren't able to transcend from the pilot stage to becoming a truly successful medium-sized corporation and then to evolve and to become the next Dangote?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, my name is Temda Oshokunmi. I'm a small business in Africa, in Nigeria and America. My question is, in order for us not to start listening to one side story, can you please tell us the challenges of subsidy, the recommendations and the solutions that you have offered the Nigerian government as regards subsidy? Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's it for questions. Dr. Ngozi, if you could respond.
Okay. So is that it?
Yes, that's it. Thank you.
Okay. Well, I guess we apologize to the others. We still have questions. Sorry. Okay. Okay, let me then. The question was, how do you focus on goals despite the challenges? And what of the Sovereign Wealth Fund? We can spend our time talking about challenges, but I think that the best way to accomplish anything is to try to think of these challenges as opportunities. You can get bogged down in the issue of problems and challenges, but if, for instance, you see the power sector as an opportunity, for investment, for improvement, then that automatically changes the way you view things. That's the way that I personally go around things. So it's not the issue of challenges, but people don't want to hear continuously about challenges from you. They want to know what is the solution. So to focus my mind, I look for the opportunities in every challenge. There must be a way of solving the problem and turning it around. And I think that that's what policymakers need to focus on. In fact, it's the problem every manager needs to focus on. How do I get solutions to this? So that is how I keep my mind on the goal, by looking for the, working constantly towards the solution to these problems. You wanted to talk about the Sovereign Wealth Fund. Just a quick word. Okay, do you want me to continue? Okay. All right, so maybe the Sovereign Wealth Fund. I think that the Sovereign Wealth Fund is doing very well. As you know, we recruited very competitively for this, the senior positions, and we got the best. And really, I'm very proud of the open, transparent process we followed. They have crafted strategies for investment for the three windows of the fund: the future generations window, the infrastructure window, and the stabilization window. And I think beginning March, they are going to begin investing. So they are gearing up to do that. We are well on our way. And we hope that $1 billion is just the beginning, that we'll be able to tap into some of the funds that we've been able to save. The federal government is ready now to put its savings, its own share of any savings, into the Sovereign Wealth Fund. So we hope to see this fund growing into something sizable in the near future. So keep tuned. Increasing high-quality education. I thought in my talk, I tried to make it very clear that this is one of the big gaps on our continent. And we need to solve it, because if we don't solve it, we are going to have problems. So not only the missing middle, I talked about the artisans, but high quality education starting even from preschool all the way up the system. We have many challenges with our education system. The challenge of access, getting enough people in, enough children, and quality. Quality is really a big problem. So I totally agree. We have a big challenge in Nigeria, as you know, and I think the Ministry of Education, sector by sector, is grappling with this challenge. We recently had a very candid report about our tertiary education system and all what is wrong with it, from infrastructure. You know, if people don't have a good learning environment, they're not going to learn, isn't it? So infrastructure is a problem. The quality of teaching is a problem. The atmosphere for learning is a problem. And making sure that we keep honesty in our system is a problem. So all of those issues have been put forward, and they are crafting a strategy now, an approach to try and tackle, including improving the basic infrastructure in our universities, and also looking towards the private sector to do more. We need partnerships. I'm not yet seeing these partnerships of the private sector with the public on education to the extent it should be. And I think this is one of the solutions that we really need to drive to within the country. But we are quite some ways away from doing this. I think the first thing is acknowledging and accepting the problems that exist. And I think at least there, we are opening up the door. Teaching is no longer valued as a profession in the country. You know, and that is a fundamental problem. So how do you restore the dignity of teachers and pay them better? These are some of the things we are looking at the moment. But we believe that the sector needs a real systemic overhaul from top to bottom. And I think the Education Ministry is grappling with that. It's going to be a huge challenge. Each time you touch our education sector in Nigeria, it creates a lot of problems. So it's also not a sector that is easy to reform. The third is SMEs. How do you go from SMEs to becoming bigger, bridging that gap between SMEs and bigger companies? Well, you know, SMEs are the driving force of many economies. In the US here, the biggest creator of jobs are not the big companies, but the small and medium-sized companies. So I'm not necessarily thinking that, you know, we should be enthralled. Maybe as an individual, you want to build your business up to the biggest. But there's no problem with having SMEs. They are the ones that really create these jobs. And I want to tell you, this program we're doing in UWIN, I know I've given that example many times, it's really exciting. If you see what these entrepreneurs have to say, some of them were employing three people. We've just done a survey, the first survey of the people who won these prizes and grants, ranging from 1 million to 10 million naira. And they've created about 6,500 jobs already. Some have gone from 3 to 6 employees, from 5 to 10, and so on. And I believe that we should strongly support SMEs. So I'm not really sure if our ambition is to bridge the gap and build every SME up to be a big company. So I'm not quite sure how to answer your question, because I believe we should be putting in place strong things to support the SME sector. And those who can grow to be bigger companies, fine. But I think if you're a strong SME, you know, that is really producing for the economy and employing, you know, your peers and so on, that is also as good. So I may be disappointing you, but that's what I think. I have a strong belief in supporting SMEs. If you want to grow your company, you know the things to do. We have to provide you access to longer-term capital. I talked about that before. We have to bridge some of these big gaps that are creating problems for entrepreneurs, such as the power, the road sector, and the port sector. And we're working on all those areas systematically. The last question was the challenges of subsidy. I'm not quite sure I understood the question. We had a big challenge in trying to phase out the subsidies. I have a very interesting chart showing where we've gone from 2005, 2006 in terms of the subsidies to where we are today. But you know, we are spending about $13 billion, or we were, before we phased back the subsidy by almost 50%. And I think that this money is being deployed to solve some of these problems that you talked about. And no matter the difficulty and the challenges that still exist, I think Nigerians should also acknowledge when incremental changes are being made. You know, I don't think it helps anybody if we just sort of deny that there's even anything that is changing. Because you see, those who went home for Christmas, I don't know if you went on the roads. How many of you did that? There was such an outcry about the roads. Yes, which one did you go on? Lekki Expressway, that's not the roads now. Hey. Okay, although that is a good example of something changing, right? You saw the toll road. But the bigger, I meant the highways. You know, like Lagos Onitsha, Abuja Lokoja. Did anybody go on those roads? Lagos Ibadan, Lagos Ibadan has not improved. I'm not claiming that the lorries are still there. I drive on the roads from time to time just to see for myself. Just like I visit the market from time to time to know what is happening. Lagos Ibadan, we had the problem of the big concession and the lawsuit, and that has now been overcome so that improvements can start. But if you went on Lagos or Onitsha, or you went on Abuja, Lokoja, down to Delta State, you would have seen some major improvements. These are the roads that people travel. Also, the railway. Now, Lagos Kano is open again and is carrying tons of passengers. You know, so these are some of the things that are moving. So we need to acknowledge it. You need to give some support where changes are being made, and by all means, be upset, knock the government for where the changes are not happening. But I want to end on a final word in saying that it's very easy to sit back wherever you are and attack, isn't it? It is. But some people have to try and solve the problem. And I think people need to have respect for those trying to solve problems.
Thank you very much, Doctor.
You know, I could have just sat back in Washington a second time around. Why do I have to go there to be insulted and abused by anybody? I could be you, sitting in the audience waiting for some Nigerian minister to come so I can attack. You know, so thank you. I want you to have respect. Some of us are there, not because we are trying to get anything. or do anything. We are there because we love our country and our continent. And those who don't want to believe it, I say too bad for you. There are actually some altruistic people who still exist, and I hope we'll get many more of you to try and do that. And please, please respect those who are trying to genuinely solve problems and not destroy them on the social media. Okay? Thank you.